The Holy Eucharist this morning begins in your prayer book on page 355. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Father in heaven, who at the baptism of Jesus in the River Jordan proclaimed him your beloved Son and anointed him with the Holy Spirit, grant that all who are baptized into his name may keep the covenant they have made and boldly confess him as Lord and Savior, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting.
Amen.
A reading from the book Genesis. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening and there was morning, the first day. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Ascribe to the Lord, you gods. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory which is his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory comes.
The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness.
We're reading from the book of the Acts of the Apostles. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul passed through the interior regions and came to Ephesus, where he found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became believers?" They replied, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" They answered, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with a baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him, that is, in Jesus." On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. Altogether, there were about 12 of them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Well, let's start at the very beginning. A very good place to start. That certainly is what we did with the Old Testament lesson this morning. If you open up your Bible to the very first page, and you start, I like having people over here when I preach, right? You get a lot of attention because of it. If you open up your Bible to the very first page and start reading, that's the verse that you'll read, the first lesson that we heard this morning, the Genesis lesson. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. There is almost no one in Christendom who is not familiar with at least a little part of that story, our story. They certainly don't get the whole thing right, but this part at least rings a bell to almost everyone in the Western world. God said, "Let there be light," and there was light, and it was good. And he separated the darkness from the light, and that was the first day. So that's how it starts. So why don't we finish telling it just really quickly and see how we do from memory, right? This is our story, by the way. We should know it. That was day one. Now, how long, according to Genesis, did it take God to create the entire universe? 6 days, right? He created a little more on day two, and then three, and four, and five, and six. Creepy crawly things, and fish of the sea, and birds of the air, and the plants and the trees, and last but not least, us. And then on the seventh day, he rested. Got it? Pretty good. Now, what comes next? The first human was a man, and his name was Adam, and Adam was lonely, and he said it is not good that man should be alone, and so he created woman, and her name was Eve, and he put them in a garden, and everything was hunky-dory. Now, there was something special about this garden. It was perfect. The lion laid down with the lamb and all of that sort of thing. it produced every single thing that the man and the woman would ever need. They didn't plow, they didn't sow, they didn't reap. It just produced. It was paradise, literally paradise. Oh yeah, and the man and the woman, they were both naked as jaybirds. So we've got that story down so far, right off the top of our heads. And there's one more thing that we need to talk about with that garden before we go on today. There was something in the middle of that garden, and what was it? It was a tree. There was a tree in the middle of the garden, an apple tree, of course, right? I've seen it in the drawings and the paintings. Had to be an apple tree. When what was that apple tree called? The tree of life, was it? Well, now I'm not so particular about the apple part, right? That's nowhere in the Bible. I don't care. That doesn't really matter. It's not the point. I'm much more concerned that we don't seem to be doing a really good job about teaching what was in the middle of that garden, what was in the center. Because yes, there was a tree in the center of the garden, and God said, don't eat of that tree. Don't touch it. Don't go near it. Don't even think about it. But in the second chapter of Genesis, it says very clearly that this tree was not the tree of life. It was the tree of knowledge. It was the tree of, specifically, the knowledge of good and evil. So, okay, we just had the name wrong, right? No big deal. It's a pretty big deal, because it's not just a name. It wasn't the tree of life. It very clearly was not the tree of life. We don't just have the name wrong, because in the fourth chapter of Genesis, we learn about another tree that was in the garden called the tree of life. There were two trees, y'all. Did you ever learn that in seminary? Did you ever learn that in Sunday school? There were two trees in that garden. There absolutely were. And unless you understand that, you're missing a big part of our story, an important part, kind of one of the points of the whole thing. God said, eat of every single tree, even the tree of life, except for that one. The tree of knowledge. Don't eat of the tree of knowledge. He put two trees there and he gave us a choice. He didn't say, I'm going to put one tree in the middle of it and it's a bad tree and I'm just going to do that for the heck of it just to see if I can throw you off your game. That's not what he did. That's not why he did it. He made us free. He made us free. And in order to make us free, he had to let us choose our own way. And in order to choose your own way, there has to be a choice, right? Our free will doesn't matter. So he put two trees in the garden and he said, choose your path. That's what God said. You may eat of one or you may eat of the other, but you can't do both. You can't have it both ways. But just so you know, God says, one of those trees is right and one of those trees is wrong. Eat of the tree of life. Don't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Don't open your eyes to evil, and you will live forever with me in the garden, eating of the tree of life. And along came the serpent, and we picked the wrong dang tree. Now, how in the world could that have happened? How could that have happened? How could we have ended up in this shape when we knew full well what the right tree was and what the wrong tree was because God told us? How could we listen to the serpent over the Lord of life? Well, easy, because we do it every day. We still do it every day. The serpent still gets in our ear and knows exactly what to say to us. And every time the world falls into chaos, the serpent says, am I good or what? He said, we all know what God said, but don't you have a mind of your own? You're evolving. You know more and more every day. You don't really need God. You can figure this out on your own. Now, you are smart enough. You're very smart. I can tell that you're smart. You can unravel the secrets of the entire universe, and you can see for yourself. I know what God said, but what do you think? What do you think? What feels right to you? Think for yourself. That's why God gave you a brain. A dear friend of mine yesterday reminded me of John Claypool. Now, I don't know if you all know John Claypool. He grew up right here in Nashville, ended up in Alabama. Maybe the greatest Episcopal preacher of our lifetime. I think he died around 2005. A giant of a man. And if you ever run across a collection of his sermons, read them. They will knock your socks off. And he said once that it really is like you see on television. Everyone on this planet has a little angel sitting on this shoulder and the little devil sitting on this shoulder. The devil sits on every shoulder individually, but he says the same thing to every single one of us because it works. And what he says is, you are right. You're right. You're right. You know best. Eat of this fruit and you will know everything. And when you know everything, you'll be like God. And then, who will need God? And truth be told, you don't really even need him now. The devil wants you to think that you know better than the guy sitting next to you. And when you realize, he wants you to be sure of it. And when you realize that you know better than the guy sitting next to you about that one issue, well, then he's probably wrong about everything, right? And then if he's wrong about everything, it's probably not just that one guy, but it's everybody that he associates with. You certainly know better than they. They're either an ignorant bunch of mouth-breathing troglodytes, or they're a bunch of intellectual snobs who have absolutely no faith at all, godless heathens. And that will continue to fester inside of you and blossom into a cancer within your soul, and it will eat you alive. And before long, we are so distracted by fighting with the other side that we cannot even think about doing the work of the church. Now, am I saying that I'm okay and you're okay and we all need to live and let live and be one big happy family? Well, you know me better than that. I'm not saying it. That's called relativism, and it's the most dangerous enemy of the church our society faces, not only because it assails us from without, but because it sneaks in from the inside as well. It says that what is true for you may not be true for me, because truth is relative. And as a traditional Trinitarian Christian, I do not believe that. I believe that truth is an absolute. There are some things that are right, and there are some things that are wrong, and that isn't up to debate. The problem is, who says who's right, and who says who's wrong? You are. You're right. We have got to quit listening to the devil, because he is convincing us to listen to ourselves, and we have already chosen the wrong path. We did that eons ago. We didn't choose the path of life. We chose the path of knowing what's best for ourselves, even though we can't. So, to whom then do we listen? Well, the church is so unpopular right now that we may be in for some dark days. So I might as well go ahead and say every unpopular thing that I can think of. We listen to the Word of God and to the teachings of Holy Church as handed down to us for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, because that's all we've got. It's what He gave us to guide us. Well, what about when the Holy Spirit says something directly to me? Be careful, weary pilgrim, because the devil has a voice as sweet as honey. You're right. That's why in the mainstream church, Catholic, when someone says, I have received a revelation from God, from the Lord, we say, thanks be to God. We will pray with you and see if we discern that same voice. Now, rough week. It's been a rough week. We've heard a whole lot of let's come together talk this week. It never lasts long when we hear it, but we have heard that. And I have to be completely honest with you and tell you that every time I hear it, I just roll my eyes. Not because coming together is a bad thing, but because we have the cart so far ahead of that horse that we may never get there. It can never work the way we're trying it. Turn to the Lord Jesus Christ as the way and the truth and the life. That has to come first. Nobody's saying it. He is right and we are wrong. Repent and return to the Lord and pray that He will heal our land. The servant of the devil says, I am right, and I will spend the rest of my life trying to convince you that I am. And the servant of God says, I have sinned from the moment I was put on this planet. And until we see a lot more confessing and a lot more turning to the Lord, the chances of coming together as one are close to nil. In the beginning, God made this world, and He gave it to us. It says that right there in the scriptures. How can we argue that we're on the right track when you look around and you see what we've done with it? Now, if I were sitting in the pews, and if I were listening to a sermon like this, I would probably be thinking about all the people who need to hear this sermon. Boy, I hope so-and-so is listening to this one, because he's wrong. Because I'm right. I confess that to you as a besetting sin. When I spend time focusing on the sins of others, I have absolutely no time to do the one thing that Jesus asked me to do, which is fall on my knees, repent of my sins, and tell others what the Lord has done for me. Now, I look around right now and I see a real mess, and you see it too. But I will tell you that the only prayer that Chad Jones can pray that will do anything at all to help the situation that this world is in is the prayer that I learned when I was very young, and it sounds like this. Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me, for I am a sinner. Amen.
As we stand, let us reaffirm the historic faith of the Church and say together the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
prayers of the people. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. We especially pray for the Anglican Church in Aotearoa, New Zealand, and Polynesia, the Southeastern Tennessee Episcopal Ministries, and the Church of the Epiphany, Sherwood. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. We especially pray for Donald, our president, Joe, our president-elect, Bill, our governor, and those in the service of our country. Danny, Jacob, Douglas, Jeffrey, Stephen, Cameron, Jack, John, and Kurt. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. We especially pray for those celebrating the anniversary of their birth: Bruce Cartwright, Gene Davis, Pat Smith, Andrew Jones, Michael Burchett, Mike Jackson, Amy Hodgson, Reverend Canon Sandy Herman, Carolyn Fay, Nancy Thompson, and Patrick Jones. And for those celebrating the anniversary of their marriage: Paul and Kim Adams, and Ted and Carol Edwards. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. We especially pray for Christy and Joe, Evan, Tony, Charles and Louise, Linda, Sheila, Honey, Patrick, Peggy, Jeff, Richard, Bruce, Jean, Patty, George, and Diane. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy Gail and all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever.
Amen."
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
All right, please be seated for just a minute. You all, I think I've told you all before that Canon Herman was a mentor in seminary, not just for me, but for basically every friend that I had in seminary. All of my dearest friends in the world have somehow been touched by Canon Herman. And Canon Herman is an Anglo-Catholic, of which they don't make them like that anymore. And how does an Anglo-Catholic celebrate his big birthday? Is before the altar. So we are so glad to have you, and happy birthday to you, Father. All right, everything is early this year. It is about as early as Mardi Gras and Ash Wednesday and Holy Week and Easter and Pentecost can be. So the bishop's calendar came out this week, And the bishop's visit will be on Pentecost Sunday, which is May the 23rd. May the 23rd is early enough that I think we can plan for the big Pentecost picnic outside, which will hopefully, if the weather cooperates with us, will be a great time. This will be when the bishop confirms. It will be 2 years worth of confirmands for us. And fasten your seatbelts, but I think that we have at least 20, close to 20 confirmands, which is an enormous class for Church of the Resurrection. So it's going to be a big day. Put it on your calendars now. You probably noticed we culled down the prayer list a little bit. It gets very long after a while. So if we have taken someone off that needs to be back on, just let us know. We'll put them right back on. Last night, Dan Kelly and I prayed the last rites. He probably within the next 2 to 3 days, he will move on into the nearer presence of his God, and that will end the last chapter of a very sad story for the Kellys on this earth. But it will begin the rest of his life in the world to come. And I like where he's going so much better than where he is right now. You all pray for Dan and pray for their children, Matthew and Katie as well, who were both just exhausted. And we had a really good meeting with the finance committee last week. I say a really good meeting. We were all breathing into our paper bags just a little bit. It is going to be a very tight year. This does not come as a surprise to anybody, but we all left with the vestry has not approved it yet. That's coming tomorrow. But we all left feeling like even if the worst case scenario were to happen for the church financially, that we'll make it through this year. We've got enough to make it through the year. And that's all God ever promised us, is that we would have enough. We're not going to worry about keeping the lights on, because the lights are going to stay on and we will continue to do the job of the church. However, having said that, it will help us in prognosticating an uncertain year. If you haven't filled out and signed your pledge card, if you're intending to do that, that will help a tremendous amount for us. Good Deacon, I know you've got a few things.
Sure, make sure that mic's clear.
I believe it's on. We are starting a new Bible study. It's open to the Women of the Covenant, the Women's Bible Study Group, but it does not exclude anyone. We will be having assignments by the e-bulletin and by email to the Women of the Covenant, and every other week we will Zoom a discussion of that assignment. So if you are interested, it begins on the 28th of January. The Book of Romans is what we are studying. And we might even talk someone into being a guest Zoomer every now and then. But if you are interested, just keep a lookout to the e-bulletin. We'll tell you how to join in. It's Pat Smith and I who will be team teaching that. And that's all.
We have a lot of birthdays and a lot of makeup birthdays. So if there are birthdays of the last 2 or 3 weeks, please come on up.
Patty J, Pat, Andrew, Gufawa.
Watch over your servants, Almighty God, as their days increase, and bless them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Happy birthday, you five. We love you.
And I think we have an anniversary, do we not?
We have 2 anniversaries.
Y'all are in December, right?
Yes,
right. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah,
right before Christmas. You all have the makeup session. Oh God, you have so consecrated the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and his church. Send therefore your blessing upon these your servants, that they may so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Pick a bride and kiss her. Good choice. Good choice.
Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most High. The sacrifice is offered to the greater glory of God with special intention this day as we request from God the understanding and wisdom and knowledge to make those good choices that He would have us make in this life. We continue with Eucharistic Prayer B in your prayer book on page 367. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is right and good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Glory, Hosanna in the
We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, Blessed William Laud, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now in the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Christ our Lord. Amen. I just wanted to take a point of celebrant's privilege right now with you, and that is, I don't know how I got to be 70 years old. I have no idea how that happened, but I always thought that people that were, when I was growing up years ago, should be ready for, at that time, a nursing home. And I'm not ready for that, obviously, as many of you are not as well. The amazing thing to me is not only that I have a loving wife and supportive family, but I also am amazed at some of the things that God has allowed me to be a part of and working through me. I am totally unworthy of that, but he has done some amazing things, and he has for you as well. So at this time of unrest in our country, I encourage you to make those good choices, like your rector was saying in his sermon, and to do the right thing for God's sake and for your sake as well. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.